It's wonderful to be with you this morning. If you can turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 8. And what a wonderful time of worship. I was like, when Ewan said, Brad's going to be up in a few minutes, I was like, there we go, that's a setup. I'm not going to preach this morning. It's just going to be worship, that's it. And it was going that way this morning. It's just an honor to be up here to give God's word to you. I do believe this is a word for us, and certainly a lot of what's happened in worship is actually right down the line of what I believe God wanting to impart to us today, and that it's this word. As I went for a run yesterday, I'm just going, God, just you want to summarize. You always, as a preacher, wanting to summarize what you're trying to say. What is God wanting to say through you in one sentence, one line? I've got about three different lines in the end, so if you want a title, "Seeing the Power of God," seeing the power of God. It's got numerous other, offshoots and whatnot, but seeing the power of God. And I was like, Lord, but there's two aspects. It's a double-edged sword today. It's seeing the power of God as individuals, and it's seeing the power of God as a people. And I really believe that that's what's come through this morning as well, is that God is wanting, there's a corporate impartation today that God wants to give to us as a family of churches, as a field of churches. And he's wanting to say today, as Andrew says, there are moments in God, in the Spirit, where God is handing something out. Where he's actually saying, as a people, do you want it? Do you want this as a people? And with one heart and mind, we need to cry out to the Lord and say, yes, Lord. With nobody out of the picture, with nobody saying, not me, with all of us saying, yes, Lord. So it's just a wonderful time of worship and preparing, I believe, even as we were on our knees first, and then the Lord saying, rise, and we all went down and up again. I believe God's just confirmed as well what he's wanting to say today. So I'm wanting to teach or preach from Matthew chapter 8 and verse 5, the faith of a centurion. When Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came forward to him, appealing to him, Lord, my servant is lying paralyzed at home, suffering terribly. And he said to him, I will come and heal him. But the centurion replied, Lord, I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I too am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say, go, and he goes. I say to one, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard this, he marveled and said to those who followed him, truly, I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. I tell you, many will come from the east and the west and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, while the sons of the kingdom will be thrown into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And to the centurion Jesus said, go, let it be done for you as you have believed. And the servant was healed at that very moment. May God bless his word, the reading of it, and may he speak to us through this, his word. So we were talking last week. We had a time as 412 leaders last week, leaders' time. And one of a couple of stories were coming out, mainly from the guys in Zambia, about how there are witches in Zambia that literally can astral travel, and people have been seen in baskets cruising through the air. And the guys are talking about how some of these witches actually travel through, they got highways in the spirit, where they actually travel on these highways, and they've mapped out highways across Africa as they go into different nations even, and appear in different nations sometimes, doing signs and wonders and whatnot, and then appear back in the same nation the same night without having driven a car. Like, it's literally traveling. And one of the things is their highways have to miss the homes of Christians. It's like, why? Because from the homes of Christians, there's beams of light going up as the prayers of the incense of the saints go up from their houses. These witches have to dodge the prayers of the saints as they head out into the nations. Isn't that awesome? And there's stories of people falling out of their baskets, you know, becoming basket cases. And I saw the one from somewhere. We heard some crazy stories, man. Peter and Arnold were telling us, guys lying in the hospital beds, literally arms moving all over the place and starting to bleed out of their ears and eyes, as it's like voodoo type stuff where witches are taking hold of these people who are ultimately under the power of the prince of darkness, of the, you know, as they're not under Christ, you're a target. And people lying in hospital beds, and you're trying to, you know, go to this person, and they're being moved by a spirit, by a power. In Port Elizabeth, I don't know if it's hit you guys yet, but in PE, even of late, there's this game, Charlie. You know, it's a new version of Glossy. I was wondering if it's linked to Charles Glass, you know, one of the, maybe it's, I don't know. The devil, you know, you'll use Charles Glass for anything. So, but one of the young guys in our church, we've got a youth group like between 10 and 12 years old, of which my son is a part of it. And so sometimes we have it at our house. One of the boys, 12-year-old, actually, after one of our meetings, said, called two of us as leaders, said, I've got to tell you, today I was in, or this week, I took part in a Charlie, where you ask, say, Charlie, if you're in the room, move the pens. And he saw the pens move. I mean, I'm like, isn't the devil quite silly? I mean, that he would do that? But you know what? There's a principle. Certainly, the devil likes to show his hand. He likes to show his power. God will often conceal his power. But the devil will show his power and get people intrigued. And it's when you give authority to a demonic power, it will gladly, you know, oblige. And we need to know the power that we have as believers. We need to know the authority that we have as believers. And God, we need to not just know the scriptures as the Pharisees did. Jesus said to them, you know the scriptures, but you don't know the power of God. We need to be a people that know both the scriptures and the power of God, that begin to delve and dig into the authority that we have in Christ, that we are not, that we do not shy away from faith and what God's called us to, and that is to be a people of faith. And that as we access faith, we access the power of God. And God is just wanting to, I believe today, just call us to being that people, a people who will see the power of God, understand the authority that we have in Jesus. And so that's kind of, that's where I just believe God's wanting to take us today. It's just one man, as one people today, to say, Lord, we want to be a people of power. We want to be a people who will see your glory come in increasing measure. That your glory, I mean, his glory is displayed through love and laying down our lives for each other. Absolutely. His glory is displayed through that. And his glory is displayed through power encounters, through moments with the King, where he breaks in to people's realities and their sufferings and their pain. But I'm not actually doing a healing teaching. So, but what I want to do is unpack this story with Jesus and look at the centurion, the faith of the centurion, and how Jesus marvels at him, and he ends up seeing an incredible healing in that moment. And I just want to unpack some things about the centurion's life, and for us to look at that and say, Lord, because Jesus says, I have not seen faith like this in all of Israel, what I see in this man. And so let's unpack a little bit of the centurion's life and believe that the end result is going to be seeing the power of God. Believe that at the end, as we look at him and say, God, you marveled at his faith. You marveled at his faith. It wasn't just his faith that Jesus can do it. It was more than that. Lord, make us that people. And I'm going to end there, but I actually believe, and I want you to listen to this, what I'm saying. I believe the favor of God is upon us. I really believe God actually gave me directive to say, well done. I believe, like, if there's going to be some things that God's going to rebuke you on, absolutely, as I get down here. God's going to be correcting stuff. He's going to be, you know, tweaking and in the chair of recalibration. But I believe the Father wants us to hear his favor is over us as a family, as a field of churches. And that's why he's even giving this message to us. He's calling us to jump. He's saying, guys, I'm offering you more power today. I believe there's an anointing for more authority today. And even those that aren't here, I believe it's going to go into our churches. There's a bigger thing that's happening here today. I see it in faith. I've been praying into it. I believe it. And it's been confirmed through words that have been taking place without knowing what I'm preaching about this morning. In the prayer meeting before, Ewan said, I feel like God wants to give us a faith like that of the centurion. And he didn't even know what I was preaching on. God is wanting to give a tick over your life today, the tick of his blood and of his presence, that he leads us in triumphant procession. And I know I'm going to throw out these statements, but it's true. It's true. The Father wants to shift us into a greater authority so that we can take his kingdom to the lost and the dying. Amen. So the first thing that I believe Jesus marveled at was that the centurion came toward Jesus. Jesus was passing through Capernaum. The centurion would have had to act on an impulse. He would have had to have acted on what he's heard about Jesus. He would have had to leave the comforts of his home. He would have had to move his feet physically and transport himself to another area and region, to the area and the region that Jesus was traveling through. He needed to get close to Jesus. He needed to be with Jesus. If we're going to move in more authority in the Lord, we need to be with Jesus. If it means getting out of our beds earlier, repositioning the posterior, if it means getting up and walking around the block, but we've got to find Jesus. The Lord has just spoken to me last week so clearly through a passage in Daniel chapter 8, where it's completely out of context in terms of what really, this prophecy has already taken place through invading armies and whatnot, but I believe it's a picture, and I'm struggling to find it. It's a picture of the demonic realm and how it works. And it's in Daniel chapter 8, and it speaks of a ram and a goat, and it was referring to, I think, the Syrian armies and how they would take over Israel and destroy the sanctuary. But this picture, as Daniel sees it in the spirit, he sees a picture of a ram and a goat. And initially there's this goat that's, in the third year, the ram, blah, blah, he saw a ram. Daniel sees a ram standing there, and it represents a principality and power. And the one principality and power is lower and higher than the other. And we know that the word says our battle is against flesh, is not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. There's different authorities. There's one legion that's like stronger. Daniel fasts and prays for 21 days. Only then does he see breakthrough. There's different principalities. And there's a picture of this principality that was acted through an army. But what it gives us, this picture of this male goat that comes from the west across the face of the whole earth without touching the ground. And the goat had a conspicuous horn between its eyes, like a weird looking creature. And it rages across the nations without touching the ground, and it gets to, this goat comes, it gets to the ram, and it tears it apart. And I just love that picture of the demonic realm, because they work together for moments, but if there's one that wants authority, I don't see them really having order except for one common purpose, and that's to destroy. But if the one really wants to take control that's stronger than the other, there's chaos. And so this one principality rips the other one apart. And what does it do? It became exceedingly great and was strong. Verse 8 of chapter 8. A great horn was broken. Instead, there came a four conspicuous horns. Then it says, what this principality, it says in verse 10, it grew great, even to the host of heaven. And some of the host and some of the stars it threw down to the ground and trampled on them. He's actually talking about angels. This present darkness type stuff. This demonic power pulls down some of the host of heaven. And tramples on them. And it says, look at this. One of the things that this goat did was it destroyed the regular burnt offerings. And the place of the sanctuary was overthrown. And from there, it says that, and a host will be given over to it, to this demonic power, with the regular burnt offerings because of transgression, and it will throw truth to the ground. What happens when you neglect our quiet times? Demonic powers throw truth to the ground. We no longer know what's right or wrong because we're not spending time in the Word. We're not spending time in God's presence, in His sanctuary. So truth is thrown to the ground, and what happens? It says that the ground becomes desolate. I felt like God say, there's a demonic power and principality that's come against every one of us, every one of the our sanctuaries. That secret place, Psalm 91, it says, He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High God. It's a secret place. Has your secret place been torn down to the ground? Where is your secret place? Are you keeping regular? Has the regular burnt offerings going up to the Lord ceased to come? Because God is saying today, it's a principality and power that's come against you to destroy that place so that He can destroy your authority. Truth can be thrown to the ground and that you can be desolate. You'll be unfruitful. And friends, let me say this. I believe Facebook first is a demonic power. If you're switching on your phones and turning on Facebook first, it's destroying our sanctuaries. It's destroying the secret place. We're looking first at what likes we get from friends and feeding our own self-worth. Where do we get our worth from? It's from the sanctuary. Psalm 27. Good old page is that. Psalm 27. One thing I have asked of the Lord, and that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. For He will hide me in His shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of His tent and will lift me high upon a rock. And now my head will be lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in His tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Let me just reverse like Russell does, right? I'm not saying it's sinful to do first, but to go on Facebook first. But how many times you go on Facebook and you're on there for 30 minutes like that? And all that's been robbed is the sanctuary, the time with Jesus. And I believe God is saying to us today, will you recognize a principality and power? It's like Facebook's run across the earth with such power and authority. And it swept the sanctuaries from the believers. I mean, I never had that when we were growing up. We never had that temptation. When I woke up before school, I woke up religiously, 5:45 before school, and I would spend time with Jesus 1 hour. 6:45, I was with Jesus. Right the way through high school. Nothing would get in the way of that sanctuary. Now it can be from 6 to 6:30 on the Facebook like this. It's gone. You don't get it back. And God is saying, it's a principality and power, friends. There's a power and principality behind it. I'm not saying Facebook's wrong and never touch it or use it. But maybe you need to. Maybe you don't have control over it anymore. It's feeding you too much and you got no more authority. And you don't even know whether Jesus is in the room or not. And if He does, you won't go and meet Him because you're meeting yourself and your own needs. And the Lord's saying, friend, come on. Why don't you make a covenant with the Lord today, even as Job did, that he covenants with God, that his eyes would not look lustfully on a woman. Covenant with God that you won't look at Facebook before you've read the Bible. Oh God, that you can see His authority breaking through your life. You can see the power of God breaking. I tell you, we'll always be busy. Always. I mean, one of the most busiest times of my life, but I've just had to keep that sanctuary. Keep that sanctuary. Oh God, help us, eh? You know, one of the accusations that Jeremiah had against, or God had through Jeremiah as he prophesied through him, he said the priests and the leaders didn't ask, where is the Lord? They just assumed He was with them all the time. They just assumed that God was with them because they are Israel, the chosen people. And we should not assume that God is just with us. He is by His indwelling presence. There's a mystery in Christ that we're hidden in Him. But man, let's not forget that God is more in some places than others. And when He's moving, we need to hear Him. We need to follow Him and pursue Him and hear what He's saying for today. He said that man will not live by bread alone, but every word that comes from His mouth. That means that we shouldn't just be, We cannot as believers just live with the food we eat, but by His word, every word that comes through His mouth. And we only get that when we're guarding the sanctuary. If you're in this place, man, I just, the Lord, and that is a problem. Just repent. Say, God, oh God, I want to get that sanctuary back in the rightful place, Lord. And I want to just see Your presence move powerfully through my life. Amen. It's through the sanctuary. It's in that place. It's through meeting with Jesus. It's through being with Jesus that he's able to make an appeal. So I'm basing everything, the rest of the points, out of this place of the sanctuary. But it's through, as he's with Jesus, he can make his appeal. If you're not with Jesus, you can't make your appeal. If you haven't found him, you can't ask him for anything. You can't just assume I'm going to ask the Lord because he's with me. No, is he? But when he's with Jesus, he makes his appeal, and that has to do with prayer. He makes a wild prayer, a radical thing. Lord, my servant is sick, paralyzed in bed, suffering terribly. And he brings that appeal. And in the sanctuary, in the presence of God, we can make those requests. And James 4:2 says, hey, man, you don't have because you don't ask. See, when there's no sanctuary, there's no asking. Or let's put that in positive. When we're in the sanctuary, when we're with Jesus, we ask. We can ask. We can ask with confidence because he's opened the way to the Father. Say, here I am, Lord, and I'm asking you. I'm asking you. And I believe the Lord is saying to us, well done, man. Well done. Many have asked. You found Jesus and you're asking. And God's saying, I'm giving you new authority today. Today, I'm giving you new authority and new anointing today. James 4:16 says, the prayer of the righteous person has great power as it is working. You know, there's prayers that some of you have been offering up and you're going, me, I'm at the front of the queue. I've been offering them up. And there's prayers that are working still now. I haven't seen some of the things happen that I've been asking for, but they're working. But you need to ask them in the place with Jesus. When you found Jesus, you're asking him for those things. Appealing to him. Whatever they may be. Call to the Lord. And he'll tell you great and wonderful things, man. Things that are hidden from us. Amen. I believe today as well that God is saying, ask me for the nations. These guys, like, they read my notes. This morning, Andrew was like reading my notes. I mean, it's ask me for the nations. Are we ready to? We had that Russia testimony. Are we asking the Lord to take what he's done among us out there into the far reaches of the earth? Are we asking him, Father, open doors for us? And I believe even today, later on, as we pray and say, Father, I've had this nation in my heart for so long. I'm asking you for this nation. I'm asking you for an open door that no one can shut. See, when God opens a door, when he does, no one, and he says, and no one can shut it, then you just walk right through. But there's some doors that are shut that he's saying, keep knocking, keep asking. And I'll give it to those who ask. In God's presence, we know the centurion, he knew the authority of the one he came to. How do we know that? Because what does he do? He calls him Lord. That word Lord is Kyrios. It's the Greek word, help me, Mark, it's Kyrios. It's K-Y-R-I-O-S. Kyrios, I think. K-U. Well, I saw both spellings, but yeah. Kyrios. It means supreme master and Lord. God, Jesus honored that centurion's faith because he knew who he has come to. He, you know, praise the Lord for us knowing the Father as Father. It is one of the primary revelations of the New Testament that's been given to us, right? That he's the Father and we are sons and daughters. But we must not forget. We must not forget that even though he is our Father, he is our Lord. He is our Kyrios. He is our supreme master in charge. And when you go to the army, as we heard with Russell, you don't debate with the commander. I remember, I might have shared, standing on the parade ground on the day that they announced, when I was in the Navy, they announced what jobs you were going to get. And I got the very enviable job of being a gate guard for a year. I was above that. I was way above that job. That job was not meant for me, and I was not meant for that job. My pay grade is way above being gate guard. I come from a pedigree of being, you know, top sportsman in our province of certain athletics things, and you know, I was head boy at school. It's like I've made the cut of the Navy, 800 out of thousands of people being scattered across the country, mainly in the army, and those poor chaps, you know, who didn't get their first choices, you know, because I got the Navy my first choice. I'm standing on the parade ground, they go, Verreynne! Guard division! It's like, what? It's like, I know I'm a troop, but do you know who you're talking to? Do you know? Do you know who I am? This is Mr. Verreynne to you, you know what I mean? Well, it was a year of humbling. And on that parade ground, I tell you what, there is nothing you can do. You can go, Verreynne and Alfanyala, all you people, so I'll speak in English, all you guys who've got any complaints, just leave it in the complaints box, you know, at the commander's office. If there was such a thing, you would never put it in there anyway, because then you'd get an even worse job. It would be a trick. When you're standing on the parade ground and the commanding officer announces your name and what your job is, you do that job. There was no getting out of it. I couldn't call my mommy. I couldn't send through a fresh CV. Excuse me, it's time. It's my time. This is not what I was meant to be. I joined the Navy to see the world. I deserve that. You know what? I stood at the gates in Simonstown and I saw the world coming past me, man. I was like, to all the tourists, how's it? They were like, ooh, like Buckingham Palace. Oh, you get photo with the guards. Yeah, this is fun. 12-hour shifts, 12 hours on, 12 hours off, 12 hours on, 24 hours off, 12 hours on at night, 12 hours off, 12 hours on at night. Those were shifts right through the night. I mean, I know what these security guards, what that feels like. It's terribly boring. Anyway, when God, if we want to have authority, we didn't know who we're coming to. We're coming to the Lord. One of his names is El Shaddai. The Lord Almighty is his name. We're coming to Adonai. Same as Kyrios, Lord, God, who is in sovereign charge and control. And when he calls you, as he did Moses, as he did Abraham, as he did Moses, as he did Noah, as he did, you know, and so we can go on, Isaiah, there's different responses. You're either falling flat on your face or you're like, hey, show me another sign, but watch out because God might, we can debate with the Lord. He's always, even though he's master, he's so kind. He debated with Moses, but there came a point where he said the Lord's anger burned hot against Moses. That's what the word says. Because he was like, oh, but Lord, after God's turned the stick into a snake, his hand, leprous, non-leprous, he's still going, but not me. Be careful, friends. His master and the Lord's anger burned hot, and eventually he was like, okay, I'll go, go. And then he goes, and he's still on his way. He's going, no, maybe not me. Friends, God is so gracious. Jeremiah says, Lord, not me. I'm only a youth. And the Lord says in Jeremiah 1, you know, don't let anyone, he doesn't say this exactly, but don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. He says, don't say I'm only a youth. My spirit's going to come on you. Friends, his master, don't say, I don't want to do that job. Don't say, friends, if we want to see the power of God move, we need to know we're coming to our Lord. And just be faithful. Just be faithful. Don't put your, you know, just, There might be time, Lord, so gracious, say, okay, give me your complaint, put it in the complaint box, but be careful that we're not like Israel, because those who murmured and mumbled and grumbled and complained didn't inherit the land. And God is saying to some of us, stop complaining. Stop moaning about your station in life. But I'm your Lord. Get in line, stand at attention, stand at ease, whatever it is. But what I'm telling you to do, do it. And so, this century knew the authority. He knew. He just says, say the word, and my servant will be healed. That's it. Daniel 7:13 says, Jesus was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All nations and peoples of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed. That's our Jesus. He is reigning. Man, when John saw Jesus, he didn't want to put in a complaint, anything in a complaint. It's Jesus with fire in his eyes. Man, this is Jesus. You just stay where you are. And if he says get up, you get up. And he says go, you go. And we need to, like Isaiah, say, here I am, Lord. Mary says, as the angel appears to her, says, you're going to be with child. The Holy Spirit's going to overshadow you. She says, I am a servant. I'm the Lord's servant. Not just daughter. Servant. Which means, yes, Lord, you know, just put the baby in me. That's fine. Whatever you want to do, God, do it. Amen. We want to see the authority, more authority. We need to learn to be so obedient to the Lord Jesus. Another thing that stands out with the centurion's life is the fact that every person mattered. A centurion is a Roman commander who's in charge of at least 100 people. There's actually, some say that the centurions were specially highly trained soldiers. They were actually like the SAS. They were the guys who, these 100 guys weren't also generally average soldiers. They were like the creme de la creme. And this centurion is not just worried about the band of brothers. He's concerned about his servant. And I just think Jesus affirmed him in such a way, he brought him in front of us so that we would copy him and be like him. That we would be concerned for the lowliest amongst us. You know, though we are these champions running forward and we're going to, oh, let's go. And what about our sick servant? What about that person, the word says that in Galatians that we should find the one that is wandering and bring them back to the faith. Do our hearts still break? Our hearts need to break for those that are not just charging in the front, but are lying back in the sick beds. And somehow we've got to have that balance in us, and the Lord will see this, and I believe he sees it actually in us. He sees the people who are going, charge, and wow, where's so-and-so? Come on. Jesus, heal that person. Bring them through. And the Lord's just looking for a people, and I believe he's saying, 412 churches, man, you're doing it. Well done. Let's not forget our sick servants. Romans 12:16 says, do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Are we associating with the lowly? Peter, when Paul and them came to confirm whether the gospel was true or not, the guy said, just do one thing. One or two things. One thing was, remember the poor. Remember the poor. The centurion, I mean, his servant was a full-blown servant who would have had to obey every single command. He was fully under his control. He didn't have to care about it. Servants were disposed of and just treated like mechanical parts. If he's sick, well, if he gets better, he gets better. But he goes, my servant is suffering terribly. He travels all the way to Jesus just to intercede on behalf of the lowly. And I believe as our hearts stay malleable, stay in that place, the Lord is going to give us greater authority. And even as Jonathan has said, in the Isle of Man, they're experiencing such blessings and favor as they're giving. Why? For equality among the churches. And what does God see? Give them more. Give them more. One of the things that that the Spirit says also through Ezekiel is that the accusations against the priests is the weak you have not strengthened, the sick you have not healed, the injured you have not bound up, the strayed you have not brought back, the lost you have not sought, and with force and harshness you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and they became food for all the wild beasts. My sheep were scattered. They wandered over all the mountains and on every high hill. My sheep were scattered over all the face of the earth, and none to search or seek for them. And I just believe the Lord saying, man, let's not be those churches. Let's be those that make provisions for the whole church. It's a distinctive. It's a distinctive of the New Testament Christianity, that we would not live and settle for Sunday Christianity. That we would not settle for, you know, just talking about how the meeting was and what it means to be, you know, in church, but that we would be the church, be living out the great commandment of loving our neighbors as we love ourselves. And purposing our lives for our brothers. And taking care of the least of us. Oh man, I shudder to think, Lord, here I am in front of you all. And actually some of you, I just have to keep low, man, because some of you are unseen caring for those weak people. Man, God is going to exalt you. I'm just going to be faithful in this place. No, nothing gets in my heart so that I just am faithful. This is a job of great prominence to stand in front of you, but God's not cared about that. He's cared about faithfulness to the text. Faithfulness to the Spirit of God and what He's telling you to do. I don't get up here as some achievement. I get up here as a faithful person. If I don't get up, I don't get up. But be faithful. What He's put in front of you, be faithful. And He's calling us to be faithful in ensuring that we are in churches that care for everyone. The servant, the weak servant, that we include everyone, leaving none behind. And that we purpose our lives to this end. Jesus says, greater love is no man than this, that He laid down His life for His friends. He purposes His life for His friends. That even as 90% of you are in business, don't shrink back from caring for people. Don't settle for a Christianity that just is an 8-to-5 and God working in that 8-to-5 space. But it's so easy to just like batten down the hatches, close the doors, build the walls, just let one visitor in to our house, you know, a month. Just open your heart, like Paul says, just like you've opened your heart towards us. Open your heart to people. Amen? Okay, I better move. How are we going to see more power? It's when we also move with compassion. This servant, this guy goes, hey, my servant is suffering terribly. In Acts chapter 17, verse 16, Paul is waiting at Athens for some of his team to get to him. And while he's there, it says his spirit was provoked within him as he saw the city was full of idols. This Roman centurion saw his servant suffering terribly, and the suffering produced action within him. We need to be careful of talking about the latest sushi. Grant, I don't know, there's an anointing from Andrew that's just flying onto you, like nailing you. No jokes, but you know, there's a worldly saying, says necessity is the mother of all invention. And as we sometimes focus on what is necessary for our city to come into wholeness, we need to be provoked in us to do something. And the centurion sees the suffering, and he can't take the fact that his servant is suffering terribly, and he's driven to Jesus for an answer. As we see the plight of orphans, as we see the poor around us, as we see the homosexual confused, etc., etc., as we see a society that's actually falling to pieces. In my son's school, parents are getting divorced like it's absolutely ridiculous to see the amount of suffering that's taking place in our children in a good old suburbia with the amount of divorces going on. I tell you, my spirit is provoked. Like, we've got to do something. We've got to do a marriage course in the schools. We've got to teach. When our children are being taught about millions and millions of years and the homo and the lady, our children... Come on, are you provoked? Are you provoked by the culture of the day just sweeping over the church? Or are we just getting like flattened? Oh, well, just Jesus, please come soon, quickly, quickly, Lord. Any moment now. Okay, I'm just... Our cult is just flattening us. Flattening us. Or we provoked. Paul gets up and he goes and debates in Athens. And he says, come on, give it to me. You want to fight? Fight me. Some of you know what I'm talking about. You want to fight? Come on. Are we letting the Spirit provoke us? Forceful men and women take hold of the kingdom, man. But we need to let our hearts break. We need to cry out for the lost and the dying in our cities, be provoked. So, oh God, that our cities would be embracing these different things that are abominations before you. God, oh Lord, help me to come up with solutions. Help me to use the media, my creative abilities. Help me to use my sport. Help me to use the workplace and how I do business. But just help me to be a shining light that shines bright for you in this crooked and depraved generation. You know, are the lost breaking? Are our hearts being broken for the lost that our businesses are being positioned to finance the work of God in nations? Are we saying, Lord, give us more so we can give more? Are we saying, Lord, how do I structure and best position my business to stand out like a sore thumb amongst a sea of businesses who are all doing things the same old way? Have we, you know, initiate prayer times? I don't know. Initiate just times of going up to employees and colleagues and just saying, can I pray with you? I don't know. Start little prayer rooms for Pete's sake. The Muslims are doing it all over the place. You don't have a choice. Why are we just standing back? Why don't we say, I've got a prayer room for you. Come here and we'll pray for you. Because we know Adonai. But we're standing with culture and it's smashing us, friends. We're standing up against it and it's smashing us. And God's saying, if you want greater authority, it's yours for the taking. Just be bold and courageous. There's a new day. Amen. There's a new day. Another thing that the servant had was humility. He says, I'm not worthy for you to come into my house. Don't even come under my roof, Lord. Jesus, I'll come to your house. He's like, don't come. And I believe the Lord just saw that man because he opposes the proud, gives grace to the humble. He sees this man who's like, oh, don't come. You just speak it. Oh, the Lord loves humility. Friends, I am scared of this building that we're building in PE. I'm scared of it. I am so scared of it. Do you know why? Because it's awesome. Our building is going to be insane. It's a prominent building. The Lord's already told us. I'm going to lift you up. He told us way before we even got the building. He's going to give us a building that is a building of prominence, and he's going to lift our name up in the city so the city can see his name. So Oxygen Life is going to become, we're meeting in schools for 14 years. Now, we've got a building, and it's going to have a kiff name on the outside. It's going to say Oxygen Life in like bright, nice colors. And people are going to come, and Christians are going to go, you're successful. And people are going to associate more than anybody in the church. They will associate Oxygen Life success to Brad and Angela Verreynne. That's what we do, right? We do that. Who leads that church? Andrew and Emma. We do that. People are going to be talking about my name. And we had a prayer meeting there a month ago. I got home. Oh. I lay in bed. I just said, God, I want to run away. I just want to fly to another nation. No, that would be nice, yeah. Oh. Oh, it sounded like, come on. I just want to get out of here. Because if people would just see how impossible this is for me to have done any of this, they wouldn't mention my name. We would just talk about Jesus. We'd talk about how he's moving in people's lives. We would say the church is, we would be trying to just put glory on Jesus, but people are not going to see it, and people even, I'm just like, Lord, the best response for me at the prayer meeting is I should have acted mad. I was thinking about it, I should have maybe rolled around. You know, like in the cement. oh, just like in my new clothes. And just with my, just rub my hair in the dirt, just put like ashes and sackcloth on me. That's I just want people to see that this is not me. It's all him. All I've been doing for years is walking faithfully, and I've got a team of faithful people around us and a church of faithful people around us, and we are seeing an incredible thing take place by moving into that venue, a miracle, an act of God, and it's going to glorify his name. And unfortunately, I'm somewhere in there. And I don't want no glory for that building. I don't want it. And I don't know how to do it. I actually don't know how to separate it myself from it, except for just staying really low. In my heart, just somehow, I just feel like, I don't know how to explain it. I just feel like doing the centipede on the floor, you know, like, shh, I actually start trying to deliver me of demons. C.S. Lewis said, there's only two responses to being in God's presence. It's to either forget about myself or to know that I'm a lowly creature unable to stand in his presence. There's only two responses to coming to Jesus. Either like, don't come near my house, Father, or like, you just forget about yourself. It's, you know, because you come, just do what you want to do. Oh, Jesus is worthy. His name is worthy. His name is worthy. His name sets the captives free. Jesus' name is the name to which every knee will bow and tongue confess. People don't get set free by Joshua generation. People don't get set free by our various church names. They get set free by the name of Jesus. I'm needing a tissue. All right, next one. Am I right there, Andrew? Okay, buddy. Thank you. Okay. I'm nearly there. I've got two more. The other thing about the centurion is he had a crazy faith. He just says, only say the word. Just say the word. And my servant who's suffering terribly, paralyzed, will be healed. I mean, Mark 9:23 says, Jesus says, with faith, all things are possible. It's funny, Ewan opened the prayer time this morning and just said, he's feeling God saying that we need to have faith this morning for the impossible. We need to believe God for the impossible. I'm like, it's just so awesome to know when the Holy Spirit is got a word for us, eh? As he has yesterday, and it's just great when he confirms it. But he has a crazy faith. He understood that Jesus can do anything, and so he gave him the impossible to do. What are you holding your faith out for? What dreams are you putting before the Lord? Are they completely outside of your ability? What are we trusting him to do? Let me say this as well. God is calling us to have a crazy faith that will also understand that sometimes not everything works out the way we think it will. So Paul and Barnabas see a crippled man walking, and the next minute they're being stoned. So where was their faith? How could they command authority over a lame person and then couldn't command authority over people stoning them and beating them? We've got to have a crazy faith that believes in the power of God, even sometimes when things don't make sense. So it's not just a faith that's saying, I believe in Jesus' name, this lame person will get up and walk. But it's a faith that says, even when the person doesn't, or even when I'm just been experiencing the other end of the wrath of the enemy, I will have faith. Crazy faith. You know, Saturday, a lot of people are asking me, I'm all good, I'm fine, I've had a bit of a heart issue. Although it was apparently a esophagus cramp. Cramping my esophagus from eating an apple. A Granny Smith apple. No, it wasn't actually a Granny Smith. But anyway, I had a really, really hectic cramp and it went into my heart and I couldn't move for 20 minutes. I was helpless. And hey, man, Lorna was in the car. Ange was there to rush me to hospital. I was driving actually, so I had to stop the car. I'm like, this is going to be fine. But I couldn't talk. And then I had to move over to the passenger seat and I was just going, I couldn't breathe, deep breaths. I was trying to tell them I'm going to be okay, but I couldn't you know, when you talk, your this is compressing, you know, and to say something, you're breathing. So it's inhaling, exhaling is have an effect on your diaphragm. I couldn't, I had only like a very marginal, very small margin to breathe in and then to choose what I'm going to say. Anyway, it was a moment of helplessness. They were praying in tongues. I'm going, I'm teaching on authority sometime this week. And this Roman centurion, I'm praying it in my head, Lord, I take authority in my head. I'm taking authority of this thing now in Jesus' name. We pray. Amen. There was nothing happening. Nothing. I'm just like, Lord, I'm ready to go. You know? It's an awesome feeling. Not the pain or anything, but it's an awesome feeling. It's in there. I'm like, yeah, Lord, you know, my family are cool. I absolutely adore my family. But yeah, I'm ready to meet with you. Like, this is it. This is awesome. This is going to be amazing. So in between that, like, Lord, no, you know, it's like, heal me. And what a privilege to be able to go on Saturday night, 3 hours or so after it's happened, and to lift up the Lord's name. See, faith the Lord's looking for is not just, Lord, I have faith for you to do that. But it's also like, even if you don't, as Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego goes, even if you don't, even if God doesn't rescue us from the fire, we still believe. It doesn't change the power of God. It doesn't change that He's seated in heaven right now, enthroned around Him, our angels worshiping the King. He's worthy. He's worthy. We will see people dying from sicknesses around us. But He's worthy. Oh man, some of the Pentecostal visitors here are going, what is this man preaching? But friends, God is calling us to a ridiculous faith that gets up again and again. We pray for the sick, regardless of what you see or don't see. We know what we see. Come on. You know, you know, this building has been a complete faith journey. Do you know, it's been an act of faith. God has said, do it, and you've had to do it. We've had to do it. I said to the elders the other day, if all of you had known how much it was going to cost for us to get in there, who of you would have said we've heard God? And all of us, to a man and a woman, the men are elders and the women in the team, but all of us, to a man and a woman, said, no ways. It was impossible if you had given us the numbers that we know now. Do you know that when we first bought the building, we were bringing an average for the last 8 years of 8,000 to 13,000 rand a month. Okay, people were giving to the building by faith that we didn't have. And then when we got the building, we said, guys, we're going to need to get that to 35 grand a month because we've got to take out a bond and we don't have enough to buy it and whatnot. And then as we bought it, we realized we've got no place for the children. So we said to the church, so the top tenants who were paying 30 grand a month had to be moved out so that we could gain that. So we said to the church, guys, we're going to need 60 grand a month. Now, if you do the maths, for the last 8 years, the church was giving on average 13 grand a month. We had to times that by 4 in a month or 2. Over the tithe. This is not tithing. This is like, guys, we need to get into that building. God has given it to us. There's my paralyzed servant over there. God wants to do something through this building. We're asking you to adjust and to find margin in your budgets and give. Oh, just by the way, guys, it's a bond for 10 years. So we're not talking about, and oh, by the way, guys, we need once-offs as well. So we need monthlies and we need once-offs because the monthlies is just to service the bond, which is not enough for us to build everything we need. So we need lump sums. Friends, we are seeing by the power of God, we've seen God move in the church. In that same month, we jumped from 13 grand a month last year, February, March, to 60 grand a month, and we're still on 60 grand a month. It is absolutely, and you know, but if you don't have faith, if we didn't have faith for God to do the craziest things, we would never have gone ahead. Thank God as well, though, in His mercy, He blinded us. So we would never, we actually didn't have that amount of faith. That's another story for another day. Praise God that He blinds us sometimes, that we do these stupid things, that actually God can then bless it because you know it wasn't by you. And I want to say to you, friends, yeah, we need faith. We need crazy faith. We need faith that we're also embracing this giving, not just as I've said to the church, we need, there's a bigger narrative here. The narrative isn't just for, and what, after 8 years, do you stop giving? No, it's actually that God wants to bring margin to all of our giving, that we live, we keep what we've already obtained after 8 years and we move on to greater things. Come on. Oh no, Brad, I've only got one building fund in my life to do. You know, Jesus, oh, you said take up your cross and follow me daily. Oh. Okay, lastly. If we want to see God move in power, this man, which is kind of a weird thing, I've meditated on this stuff a bit, but he says to Jesus, I'm a man under authority. In fact, he says, I too am a man under authority. Now, that is hectic. That was insight and revelation that only the Spirit could have given him. He knew that Jesus was operating under the authority of someone higher than himself. And so he says, I know how this authority thing works. You are under orders and you obey them. And so, you know, if you will say the word, then those under you will obey it. He understood authority. I want to say, if you want to walk in more authority, Jesus is saying, are you under authority? Are you under authority? What does it mean to be under authority in the local church? What does it mean to be authority? Do you know this preach, the only reason why I've gone longer than 40 minutes is Andrew said I could. If Andrew says 40 minutes, I would have been finished 15 minutes ago or however long it is. I've been going, I think 54 minutes now, somewhere there. Andrew said, go for it, feel at liberty and just minister, and I'm checking him. But if Andrew says 40 minutes for me to preach him, I get under his authority and I obey that. When I went to the nations in Zambia with a guy called Henny Cater, I traveled with him, he said, Brad, I would want you to share at the conference we're at. You got 5 minutes. Now, as a preacher, I mean, that's my introduction, like, of my life, you know, just to let people feel like connect with me. That's what we do sometimes. Henny Cater says 5 minutes. You know what? I prepared a message in 5 minutes, the best thing that I could do in 5 minutes, boom, bang, off, and I'm walking off the stage under 5 minutes. Why? Why? Because that's what Henny asked me to do. And when we sit in our meetings, our elders' meetings, our church meetings, we don't just take, we listen as if God is speaking to us. My dad is 69 years old. He takes notes. Every preacher he goes to, he's been a preacher for 41 years. He sits there taking notes because why? He wants to come under the authority of the word of God to him for that day. I'm like, I said to the leaders the other day, I said, guys, to be under authority in this church, and I said this only to the leaders. First of all, I was thinking about the building fund. I looked at our building fund and I saw, well, we've only got 60 to 70 monthlies that are coming in. Now, if you do all the calculations, we're probably short of about 100 to 150 people in the church that are actually giving monthlies. So I thought immediately, texted the elders, are all of you giving? Why? Because if they're under authority, we're all possessing this land together, which means you all are just like me. I am checking, oh, the guys just bought, give me something, please. We just bought a new microphone. Oh, well, there's like, you know, 2.5K. If I stop giving whatever mine is, if it's 100, well, I'm 100 less to getting that. I mean, you know, $6 for this water. Somebody had to buy it. You know, and so you go as you're building, especially me, I feel like more a builder than a jolly church builder, you know, people builder. You buy a bolt for a door, it's $100 for a hook. And I think, hey, some folks are going, oh, I don't know if I'm going to give them 100 this month. I'm like, that was the hook. Like, I mean, I went up to the shop. I had to go buy their door hooks. I was shocked. 350 rand for 4 silver hooks. I'm thinking, I've seen some of the money coming. I'm like, that was one person's whole month. Some people, it's like their 4 months worth of giving was that hook. Like, oh God, what an honor. Like, take these hooks, like, put them there. If you want to have authority, you need to. So I went to the leaders. I said, you know what? If you are truly under authority, if you are building with us as a church, I feel like I have a right to ask you, even as Russell said yesterday, how do you raise leaders? They must be in your rib, in your kidneys. We need to be able to ask our leaders. Leaders, are every one of you giving monthly? If you've had some situation, you've lost your job, and live free, man. If you've had a reduction in salary and you've now, but man, live up to that which you've already attained. Or if you can't, because things have changed, reposition, but keep the margin. Don't lose the margin, because we're all going to possess this land. And if you're in authority, man, you will have authority. And so even for you guys, if your elders are telling you preach 40 minutes, you preach 40 minutes. If you ask to follow up on somebody, you follow up on that person. You live under authority, and you know then that that's how God works. And we, you know, my son, we don't do it. You know, you can be under authority, but not be submitted. Right? So, Andrew, I'd love it if you could just quickly go get me a glass of water. Okay, fine. Yes, I know, gee. Okay, fine. All right, guys, I'd love it if we could all just see that this building project is in God and we all need to give to this thing, guys. Okay, fine, buddy. I'll just, there, how's that? There's my money, all right? Hope you're happy now with that, bro. So, you're not under authority. You know, God doesn't dig it when we mumble and grumble and complain. In fact, the word says that we shouldn't be grumblers and complainers. And if we want to walk in more authority, we need to be like the centurion says, you're under authority. He says, I also am a man under authority. This is how it works. When you say, it gets done. I'll go here with a servant. Friends, God is saying to us today, He's saying there's an affirmation to us today that, well done, you are, I believe, as a field, God is actually saying, you're like the Roman centurion, well done. And then at the same time, there's some of us who he's not saying that to you, he's actually saying, you are not like that. There's actually areas that you need to bring to the Lord today and repent. And as you bring those things to the Lord and adjust, stop your grumbling, complaining, be properly under authority. Some of you are going to need to repent to leaders, etc. You know, as you come under authority, the Lord is going to give you authority. And we're going to take nations. Amen. Can we have the musos up as we... I'm also believing for an impartation this morning for us to step over a line into seeing God do great things. A line of faith. We're going to jump off that proverbial wall into our Father's arms and say, Lord, I want to be like the centurion. I want to be like the centurion in humility. I want to be like the centurion with crazy faith. I want to be like the centurion in all these points that I've mentioned. Lord, I want to be like this guy. And we're going to ask him also for the name. We've already done that as well, but there's some of you here, there's those seeds that have been planted. And the Lord's saying, ask me today, as you make those adjustments, I'm going to give them to you. Can we pray together?